For more updates on the protest, I'm joined by Senior Programs and Research Manager, Corporate Accountability and Public Participation Africa, Zikora Ibe. Thank you for joining us on the news this hour. Even though government acknowledges the right to peaceful protest, it continues to appeal to organizers of this protest to shelve it and give it some more time. I'm wondering how you react to concerns that this exercise could turn violent and hinder, innocent citizens and inspire destruction of public property.
Thank you so much. Yes, so the government has been speaking about the possibility of the protest turning violent, and it is right to, exercise that kind of concern. But it is important to establish that when conversations about the end bad governance in Nigeria protest first started on social media, Twitter to be precise, it started as a genuine concern by Nigerians to the prevailing conditions of economic hardship, and their intent to express their concerns to state authorities and elected representatives. And at no point of these conversations were there any talks about vandalizing properties as people go out, or hijacking people's goods and stores, or engaging in any criminal activities. It was just a conversation and an intent expressed by citizens to peacefully assemble and to make their grievances known. We began to hear rhetoric of violence, if I may say, from, unfortunately, from state authorities, from elected representatives who continue to undermine the rights of citizens to say that they want to go out. And we think that if state authorities are very much concerned about the possibility of the protest turning violent, it's also within their obligation to guarantee that the protests or demonstrations held anywhere in Nigeria does not turn violent. That is what the police are there for. And we are hoping for a situation whereby the police does not just continue to receive intel, as it has told us in recent times, of the protest possibility of turning violent, but to take action on that sort of intel it has continued to receive and to express. In recent times, even as we've seen state authorities caution on good behavior from protesters and ask them to remain within behaviors that are acceptable by the law, we've also seen videos on social media of people who are rejecting the planned protests, and they're within their rights to reject those planned protests. But what we have seen from people like that is they also going around to reject planned protests and to also threaten people who have vowed to come out to protest and to express their grievances.
I hear you, Zikora. Interestingly, we've seen security agencies engage stakeholders in that regard. The IGP met with organizers of the protest and CSOs, as well as the NBA recently. But precisely, do you think that protest alone can bring about change without engaging with government to have dialogue? Which do you think necessarily should come first? Because it will sound as if government is saying, let us dialogue instead of people going to the streets. Do you think marching on the streets alone can bring about the desired change that the people need?
I think when you say dialogue, then we have to ask ourselves, what exactly is protest? Because a protest is a form of expression, and that expression is guaranteed within the Constitution. It is a democratic behavior that allows citizens to engage the elected representatives. So the talks about dialogue and protest can sometimes be confusing when we tend to misunderstand what protest itself, peaceful protest itself mean. The idea of a peaceful protest is for citizens to come out, to assemble and to freely speak and to ventilate, and also for government to be able to understand where the pains of citizens are coming from and know how to do better and work better together and, just foster an inclusive participatory governance. So when we, I think there's a misunderstanding when we talk about dialogue and we talk about protest, we seem to try to differentiate the both of them. But really, what is a protest? A protest cannot hold without dialogue. When people gather, they gather to speak, they gather to dialogue, they gather to express, to freely express themselves. So the protest itself is a first step towards engaging the government.
Well, and perhaps, perhaps the difference is that a dialogue is more organized between, you know, two different parties who have opposing opinion about an issue, and then they can sit across the table to discuss and, you know, put down your request and hear what government on the other side is saying. But let us take this conversation a little bit forward to talk about what we have seen in the past. A lot of reference has been made to what transpired in 2020, the issues in Kenya recently that went out of hand. And, you know, government authorities have said that protests often end in violence and destruction of property. You talked about the mobilization on X. Do you think that mobilization has also included the peaceful element of this protest? Is that something that has been prioritized? Do you think that people are also advocating that, of course, we have the right to protest, but it's also important that we do it peacefully, you know, without infringing on other people's rights?
Yes, of course, that has been part of the conversations. At no point has the conversations or have the conversations on social media been about people going about bad behaviors or trying to engage in illegal characters that are, you know, foreign to what we ought to have. Because the protests have largely been about people peacefully getting together and, you know, discussing the affairs of the country. And really, for each time we've had a protest in this country, most of the times, the protests have always culminated at the State House or at places where protesters can engage the government or state representatives. So I don't know why this particular protest is foreign. It shouldn't be foreign to government. What government should expect is to make themselves available for protesters. Protesters have said, this is where we are going to be, this is where we are going to gather to discuss the affairs of this country, to discuss what ails us. What government can do is to make itself available. It is an obligation of the state to actually listen to people, to actually provide security, to make people feel safe, and not to try to undermine that kind, undermining the legitimate grievances of people only starts wasn't the case, really. Well, and I guess, if there are talks about security, I think that it is the duty and still the duty of state authorities and the police to provide maximum security for not just the protesters, but even for individuals going about their normal businesses on that day.
Well, I guess we count on the listening ability of government and to also, you know, match words with action with its intent to engage protesters and also resolve the challenges that have been highlighted. Zikora Ibe is Senior Program and Research Manager with Corporate Accountability and Public Participation Africa. Thank you for talking to us.
Thank you.